Hello, I'm Nadira Hira, your MC for this year's SDG Global Festival of Action. And I'm so excited to be presenting one of our very special Turning Point Dialogues. On the heels of a year full of challenges, a global pandemic marked by economic, political, and social turmoil, we've seen dramatic shifts in how we think about living and earning, consuming, and producing. Things that were deemed too ambitious or expensive even to entertain before now seem not just doable, but downright imperative. Which means that this incredibly difficult moment may also be a potentially unparalleled opportunity to build a more just and sustainable society. So, how do we, together, make this a true turning point for people and for planet? Here to talk about it with us is lifelong campaigner and advocate, a former Secretary General of the Global Civil Society Alliance, Civicus, and the current CEO of Oxfam Great Britain, Danny Sriskandaraja. Welcome, Danny.
Hi, Nadira. It's great to be here.
Thanks so much for being here with us. And I guess let's just get started. It'd be impossible to make 2021 a turning point without first understanding the very real impact the pandemic is having and recognizing what a risk the current context poses for progress. So can you talk to us a little bit about how you see the pandemic worsening inequalities and poverty, and perhaps where the broadening inequalities have startled you the most?
Yeah, look, early in this pandemic, many people were calling it the great leveler because, you know, all of us could have become infected. But I think as the year went on, what's become clearer is this pandemic has really deepened some of those inequalities that many of us were already worried about. For me, what was startling is the great reversal that we've seen when it comes to extreme poverty. You know, we've all should be so proud of the amazing progress that the world had made on reducing levels of poverty. But, mm-hmm. you know, our estimate at Oxfam is that up to 500 million more people could be pushed into extreme poverty as a result of the disruptions from the pandemic. And then another startling aspect was how the disruption to the global supply chains have really hurt people, you know, across the world. You know, when consumers in the West stopped buying clothes, it meant that in some cases overnight, garment workers in Bangladesh or Cambodia had no employment. But worse still, they also didn't have access to the sort of social protection, government handouts or social subsidies that were on offer for many people in the West. So, you know, we've seen particular vulnerability amongst people who were just starting to see the benefits of being involved and connected in global trade networks. And that's been particularly worrying.
No, it makes absolute sense. And it's also one of those things that when everybody is under so much pressure, we're perhaps not paying as much attention to how that supply chain, those challenges actually operate. But I guess as we think about that, and we think about all these new and maybe more nuanced challenges that are trickling down from the pandemic, what's your vision for how we might recover better? Is there opportunity in this crisis? And what role do governments, businesses, and individuals, all of us, have in driving change from your perspective?
Look, I think there is an opportunity not just to build back better, as many people say, but to build back fairer. You know, like you said at the outset, this is an opportunity for us to throw out some of the old rules and be truly creative to make sure this is a turning point. I think a good place to start would be on access to vaccines. You know, this COVID vaccine is going to be such a precious resource for all of us to get back to something like normality. But what's deeply worrying is that countries in the global north have secured far more vaccines than are necessary. And again, by our estimate, something like 9 in 10 people in the global south are unlikely to receive a vaccine anytime in 2021.
And, so this, you know, entire year?
Yes, for this whole year. And so we really need to correct that, not just by making sure that rich countries donate more to collective efforts like COVAX to distribute vaccine, but to call on the big pharmaceutical companies to share intellectual property, to share technology transfer, so that we can make sure that there are enough doses to make sure that all people across the world are protected. And then I think comes this question of social protection. You know, for me, this pandemic has revealed that inequality about the sort of social floor that people have access to, that in many parts of the world, people have access to pensions, to savings, to government protection schemes. But for most people on the planet, they don't have that bare minimum to absorb the shocks like this pandemic. And I think this is an opportunity for us to think about, you know, as a civilized humanity, what is that basic floor that we think every human being should be entitled to? And, you know, I hope we can think about new bold mechanisms for doing that. A third element, I hope, of the sort of mix of ingredients, if you will, to build back fairer is to think about gender equality. You know, this pandemic has also been worrying for opening up or revealing the injustice of gender inequity. You know, women have borne the brunt of this pandemic through caring responsibilities, through the fact that they make up the majority of health and social care workforce. And for me, this is an opportunity for us to really revalue women's work in the economy, but also through unpaid care, and rebalance how we reward people who care. You know, again, Oxfam estimates that something like $11 trillion worth of care is provided on an unpaid basis by women around the world. That's three times the size of the global tech sector. And yet we celebrate tech giants and tech entrepreneurs, but people, especially women who predominantly provide these sorts of caring services that are essential to our society, to our economies, are not being recognized and rewarded. And I hope this is also the opportunity for us to rebalance that equation.
It's so tough in this virtual environment because I literally want to like jump out of my chair and say yes, yes, yes to everything that you're saying, but I want to make sure people can hear you. But all of that sounds so grand and yet so intuitive. In a way, it's kind of like, why are we not already here? And how sad actually that it's taken this reset, this great leveler to even get us to this place. But to your point, there is an opportunity there. And I think thought experiments like finding a floor for all of us that everyone ought to have are amazing. But I think I'm curious to hear on a practical level, what do you think we all need to do who have the resources, who have the reach in any way to actually just support and amplify these efforts? What is a practical thing everybody out there can do right now to help advance the goals you're talking about?
Well, I think for individuals, we have to be asking ourselves, are we doing enough? You know, this is one of the biggest shocks that almost all of us have faced in our life. And if we are activists who care about sustainable development, who want radical action, I think we should be asking ourselves, are the sorts of things we're thinking about, the solutions we're proposing, really bold enough? And I'd particularly challenge those colleagues who are in business, in the private sector, to also be bold, to think radically about how you can make sure that your business plays its rightful role in promoting a just recovery, and to lead the way in sort of building back fair. And, you know, businesses, whether it's through the way that they treat workers across their global supply chain, the way that they give, complete feedback loop so that communities and workers are given voice, or just being, you know, progressive allies to others, to activists, to give them the space to make those radical arguments, have a really important role to play. And I hope, you know, this festival is a moment for us to sort of inspire and challenge each other to make more radical interventions.
It's a lovely thought. We have been through a radical shock, but it allows us to create a radical, not just response, but movement and support all of the good work that's been happening up to this point. So all of this has been great. Danny, we could talk to you forever. And I think you know that. But we'd love to just end on a note of inspiration. You inspire so many of us. We would love to know what inspires you. Is there a piece of art, piece of music, a book, a podcast, a person that moves you that you think our festival participants ought to check out too?
Well, for me, it's not a person, but it's the people I meet. You know, I, as you said, I worked for 6 years as Secretary General of Civicus. And now even in this job at Oxfam, one of the greatest privileges I have is to meet activists around the world. You know, often young people, often people who don't hold positions of power, but who are taking the things into their own hand. You know, people who are calling out corruption, young women who are tackling gender-based violence in their own community, often using technology and platforms that people of my generation don't quite understand, but really coming up with practical solutions to what we thought were age-old challenges. And that's what sort of keeps me inspired, because there's a new energy. You know, we're in a dark period of human history, but I think the way that many young people especially are facing up to that is really inspiring.
That's wonderful. And the beauty of these platforms, as you say, is we can connect in a way that we never were able to before. And it really creates an opportunity, as you say, in this moment and hopefully for the future. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Dani Srishkandaraja. We hope to see you again here at the SDG Global Festival of Action. And we are wishing you all the best. Thank you for everything and for being with us.
Thanks, Nadira.